The distalmost joint of the upper limb that we're going to discuss is your wrist joint, and more properly referred to as your radiocarpal joint. Now, what's important here is we're talking radio, so meaning that we're talking about your radius, not your ulna. The ulna is not actually involved in your wrist joint. It plays such a big role in terms of the elbow joint, it actually doesn't extend all the way down to the wrist. So just the distal radius is playing a role here. So let's look at the bony parts of the joint. So we're talking distal radius. And actually, if you were to look at a completely distal view of the radius, you would see this nice shallow area that's able to actually fit with this proximal row of your carpal bones. Now, remember in our discussion of the carpal bones, you have two different rows. You have your proximal row, which is composed of four different bones, as well as a distal row, another four bones. The proximal row is made up of your scaphoid bone, which is your most lateral, the lunate, the trichetrum, and then also your pisiform right here. And if you recall, your pisiform is actually an example of a sesamoid bone, which is formed in your flexor carpi ulnaris tendon. And the pisiform is not actually included within this radiocarpal joint. So it's not actually articulating with the radius, just the other three bones, the more lateral bones. Now, the radiocarpal joint is an example of a chondyloid joint. And we don't talk about chondyloid joints very much because there's not really that many in the body. But this is a nice example of one. And in a chondyloid joint, you have the capability of flexion extension, abduction or abduction, which we also refer to as radial deviation. So you think about abduction moving on the radial side of the wrist, whereas adduction or adduction is moving on the ulnar side of the wrist. Now, because you have flexion extension, abduction, and adduction, you're capable of circumduction, that complex movement of those four. So let's actually look at those in the wrist joint. We'll start with flexion and extension. So we have flexion is the movement anteriorly, extension, moving back into anatomical position, and you actually have quite a range of motion in terms of hyperextension, so past anatomical position. Now, if you look at abduction and adduction, you can see with abduction or radial deviation, you're moving away from the body, and then adduction back, so back towards the ulnar side. Now, in this area, you're also going to have the distal radial ulnar joint. So we discussed the proximal radial ulnar joint, which is closely associated with the elbow. Now the distal radial ulnar joint is more closely associated with the wrist. So this is an additional area for pronation and supination. Now recall, as we discussed, that when we're talking about pronation and supination, the moving bone is the radius. The radius is the part of the bone that's actually moving or rotating along the ulna. So you have the radius moving along the ulna, and importantly, muscles that are going to affect pronation and supination are actually only going to attach or have its more distal attachment on the radius. Now that concludes our discussion in terms of joints of the upper limb. Now let's move to the joints of the lower limb, which we'll find have very close connections and very close associations as you have with the upper limb.